EUV is a tough problem to solve, so there are a lot of challenges still remaining in the field which needs to be solved for commercialization of this technology. So what I want to do in this video is point to you the grand challenges. I want to focus on three of the biggest challenges. So the first one relates to the source, that is, how do we generate these photons with the extreme ultraviolet wavelength, or wavelength of 13 nanometer. And so that's the first challenge I want to talk about. The second challenge I want to talk about is how to then take these electrons, focus them, take them through this path, and take them through the resist. And the second thing I want to focus on is essentially the optical component of it. So how to design the optics, how to design the mask. And the third biggest challenge in the field that I want to mention is relating to the resist. So relating to the resist that is required for EUV. So let's start first with the source. So as I mentioned previously, that if you operate in this extreme ultraviolet wavelength, you require a very high energy photons, which get absorbed with pretty much everything that comes in its way. So how, first of all, how, first things first, how do we generate these high energy photons? So let's discuss a little bit about the physics of these excimer lasers and how these high energy excitations are generated. So even for deep EUV lithography, the photon energies that we require are 5 eV for this 248 nanometer deep UV, and 6.4 eV for this 193 nanometer wavelength that is currently being used. And how they are generated are, they are generated using this thing called excimer laser. And what it means is that you essentially have an excited state of matter. So you have a plasma, in this case consisting of essentially noble gases or noble halide gases, and you excite them to have some positive charge on these species. So for example, say you have argon fluoride, so you would excite it such that it already has a positive charge. So you generate this excited state, and when you already have positive charge on your atom, these electrons in your orbital are now more closely bound with your nucleus. And now when you have a electron transition, you get this high energy. So to generate this EUV wavelength, you actually need a very excited state. So what they commonly use is tin, and that to a very excited state. So tin with three or four electrons already removed from it, so it's highly positively charged. And then these d level of electrons, when they transition back, they generate this photon which has this very high energy of 92 electron volt. So first of all, since it get absorbed by, at this energy, your photon gets absorbed by everything, to generate this plasma, or to generate this light source, everything has to be in vacuum. So one of the challenge in this thing to generate this EUV photon, or actually transporting this EUV photon all the way to your wafer, is that all your optics, all your mask, all your generation source have to be in vacuum. So let's look at two possible ways we can generate these EUV photons using tin. So the first one is actually using what is called a laser pulse plasma. And this figure here describes how it works. The company which has been most active in this field is Kimer, which is based in San Diego in California. So the way this works is you focus this laser, and then you fire a pulse of this laser. So you fire a pulse of this laser onto your incoming droplet, and you hit each of these incoming droplets with this laser, which puts these thin droplets into the excited state, and when it relaxes from there, it generates this EUV photon. So it generates these EUV photon, and then you have this mirror over here which focuses them into an intermediate focus point, and then you pass it on to the next level of optics. So one of the challenges with this technology is you need to have a very synchronized fashion of these droplets falling, and then you need to hit each of them using this pulse laser. So it reminds me of one of those games that you play, like Pong or Angry Birds or Pac-Man, where essentially you need to hit your incoming target with to score points, and that's exactly how it works. So this one, it shows you a image of these droplets falling, and each of these droplets is between 50 to 100 micron in diameter, so it's a very small target to hit, and you need to hit them, each of them, with this pulse of laser, and they're falling at a rate of 40 kilohertz, so you need to be very precise, and you need to keep on hitting them with a very high precision, otherwise it's game over. And another challenge is, once you have these thin droplets, there's a lot of tin which ionizes, and which there's a dearth of another problem is collecting this dearth of tin. So there's a challenge that what if this tin, it falls on this mirror, or it falls on some of the optical components over here, and that's another challenge with this technology. The other way to generate this EUV photon is this other competing technology, which is also a plasma, but generated not by laser, but instead using a discharge pulse. And what it means is, essentially, you have these two tin baths. So you have two of these baths which are filled with molten tin, and you have these discs rotating, and they essentially pick up these tin on its surface whenever it dips into the bath, and then you hit one of these circles. You first of all, you apply a voltage here, and then you hit this with a laser pulse, and again that generates tin in this excited state, and when it relaxes you get these EUV photons. And here's a company called Extreme Technology which is generating this competing technology for generating your EUV photons. So the main common challenge for both of these is that it needs to be operate in a vacuum environment. The plasma itself that you use for generating these EUV photons, that same plasma can absorb this EUV photon as well. So again, the efficiency you get of your photon generation is quite low. So awesome, at least we know how to generate these high energy photons now. So what's next? So what's next is now taking these high energy photons, so taking these high energy photons and then focusing them onto your wafer, and also using this mask, running them through this mask to generate the pattern on your wafer. And again, a challenge there is how to, so out of this optics which is needed for focusing your photons or the mask, it has to be all in vacuum, because anything, any air in between will essentially absorb these high energy photons, and it will just reduce the number of photons you have available. And the other challenge is that you can't use any lenses. So typically for deep UV or immersion lithography, you essentially run your incoming photons through a series of lenses, and that focuses them, but you can't do this if you have photons of energy of this high energy. They'll essentially, all of them will get absorbed within this lens and you won't get anything out. So you need to use these, so you can't use any lens optics. So lens optics is completely ruled out.